Welcome to the Magnet seminar. The seminar format is as usual, 25 to 30 minutes presentation when you can keep your microphone muted and turn off your video if the connection is poor. It will follow 10 to 15 minutes questions and discussion time. And at the end, if you're interested, you can stay for an informal catch-up that is not going to be recorded. Today, I'm really happy to have here Raquel Bonillalba. She's gonna present a presentation with the title Variations of the Geomagnetic Field for the Last 4,000 Years in Central Asia. So Raquel, please take it out. The floor is yours.
Okay, thanks for inviting me to Magnet. In this talk, I'm going to present some results of my PhD in which we studied the variation of the geomagnetic field for the last 4,000 years in Central Asia. So it's well known that the geomagnetic field is not static. It changes in space, as we can see in this first figure for the chaos model, but also it changes over time. So if we want to understand and characterize the geomagnetic field, we need a well-distributed database. This is not a problem nowadays, thanks to direct measurements provided by satellites and geomagnetic observatories. But if we want to go back in time, we need indirect measurements provided by paleomagnetism and archaeomagnetism. Specifically, the archaeomagnetism study the past geomagnetic field recorded in archaeological material that was heated to high temperatures in the past. Unlike the database provided by the satellites, the archaeomagnetic database is not well distributed over time, as we can see in this figure, for the intensity, declination, and inclination, but also more than the 95% of the archaeomagnetic data come from North Hemisphere, and more than the 50% of this information comes from Europe. If we focus in Central Asia, we can see that we have a database for the intensity, but this data do not meet the current quality standards. Also, if we check the declination values, we can see that there is no data for the moment. And in case of the inclination, we just have few values for this parameter. So the objective or the motivation of this study is not only to provide the new data, but also to cover a spatiotemporal gap which is characterized by the sharp changes in the intensity, like the Levantine Iron Age anomaly, or to define the intensity peak that was observed also in Europe between 600 and 400 BCE. So the objectives of this work was to provide the first high quality intensity data from Central Asia, and also the first full vector for this area, and try to know the behavior of the geomagnetic field in Central Asia. To estimate the paleointensity and the direction of the past geomagnetic field, we use the Tellier-Tellier method. So we heat the samples from 100 to around 600 degrees by applying a field of 50 microtesla. And to calculate the paleointensity, we use the specimen that have one single magnetic component pointing to the origin to the sidereal plot, but also lineal arrays. Also during this experiment, we perform PTRM check to try to identify alteration or mineral alteration within the heating process. And if the difference between the PTRM check and the TRM was higher than the 10%, the specimen was rejected. Also to ensure the reliability of our results, we perform different corrections. The anisotropy TRM correction that is especially important for for archaeological material. Here I present this study for Gomez Pacar et al. And we can see that the intensity before of this correction was around 100 microtesla, and after the correction was 52 microtesla. This effect was also studied by Osset et al. And here they show the values of the intensity for each specimen per sample. And we can see large difference between them, even more than 50 microtesla. But when the anisotropic correction was applied, we can see that this difference is lower than at the beginning, even less than 5 microtesla. So here is the importance of this correction for archaeological material, especially for ceramics. Also, we perform the cooling rate corrections. So to analyze the geomagnetic field in Central Asia, we studied different archaeological material, in this case, kiln and ceramics that were sampled from different archaeological sites located in south of Pakistan. And these samples were dated between 2000 BCE and 1429 CE. We analyzed 76 ceramic fragments for 6 archaeological sites that we saw in these pictures. But also we analyzed 126 samples from 9 different kilns that also appears in this figure from 3 archaeological sites. So to analyze the principal magnetic minerals that carry out the magnetization of these samples, we perform thermomagnetic curves where we present the magnetization versus the temperature, but also the susceptibility versus the temperature. So here we can see that the heating curve and the cooling curve are almost the same, are quite similar. So it means that there is no alteration during the heating process. Also, for this experiment, we obtain Curie temperatures ranging between 400 degrees and 600 degrees, corresponding to magnetite and titanomagnetite. But also for the susceptibility versus the temperature, we saw different in some samples, these peaks around 300 degrees and 400 degrees. For rock magnetism experiments, we perform also hysteresis slopes and day diagrams. And with this experiment, we saw that the saturation for the hysteresis slope was reached around 150 microtesla, which is associated with the magnetite. And with these parameters, we plot the day diagram. And we saw that almost all of the specimens that we studied lays on the pseudo-domain area. Just few of them was in multi-domain area, let's see, which is possible because these samples have high coercitivities that maybe could be associated with magmite and hematite. We also perform IRM and Lowry test, and here we observe a medium destructive fields around 30 millitesla. It's also associated with magnetite. And in some cases for the Lowry test, we saw some samples with a high Curie temperatures that also could be associated with magmite and magnetite. So the conclusion for the rock magnetism experiment is that the main ferromagnetic minerals which carried out the magnetization of these samples were magnetite and titanomagnetite, but in some cases we can also show magnetite, magmite, and hematite. For the intensity analysis, we analyzed 551 specimens from kilns and ceramics. Here we saw some specimens that were accepted, some of them that were rejected. Here, for example, we see not just one component of the magnetization, but also some alteration during the heated process. We were really lucky because more than around the 70% of the specimens were accepted. And also we analyzed the anisotropy correction that varies the values of the intensity up to 34%. And the cooling rate went up also to around 13%. But the mean value was around 5%, which is also according with the previous geomagnetic studies. So here we present the intensity versus the time, and we present all of the data that the intensity data that we obtained during the PhD with the present models, geomagnetic models. And in blue, we present the values for the ceramics, and in red, the intensity values for the clays. We tried to cover the last 4,000 years, but for the moment, we still have some gaps. For example, around the first millennium BCE, but also in some cases for the last centuries. In terms of the full vector of the Earth magnetic field, we present the first nine full vector for this area. And also to ensure that we have really good results for the direction, we calculate the mean value with at least 10 specimens, and we obtain that the alpha is less than 4 degrees, and the K parameter was higher than 100. So here it's an example of the direction of one specimen that was obtained with the AF demagnetization. And here we present the stereo with all of the direction that we calculate during the PhD. In dark blue, we have the oldest kilns, and in the red one, it's the more modern structures. So to understand the geomagnetic field for this area, we make a comparison between the previous data, our new data, and the paleo reconstructions. All of them was the previous data that we choose was the previous database base that was around Termef from 1,000 kilometers around Termef, which is where we relocalized all of the data. And if we focus on the declination, we can see that there is no previous data, so we present the first declination values that seems to fit well with the previous model, and the largest difference can be found around 150 BCE for the declination. And in terms of the of inclination, we can see that the previous database has have 186 inclination data that was really dispersed. And the largest difference between our new values and the paleo reconstructions was around 200 CE. But for the last centuries, we can see that the models and the data seems to fit well. Here we present the intensity versus the time. And in this case, also we choose the previous database around 100 kilometer from Termef. And in this case, we present in blue dots are the values for the intensity for obtaining with the ceramics. In red dots, the ones obtained with the kilns, and the black dots was the previous studies but high quality intensity data, and in gray the previous data without correction or with less than those that these values were obtained with less than three specimens. So, but we can see that our new data seems to fit well with the previous one. So here also we compare our new data and the global reconstructions with the paleosecular variation curve for the intensity that we built during the PhD. So we can see, for example, that around the intensity increased from around 1,500 till around 900 BCE to high temperatures, sorry, high intensity around 70 microtesla. And this high intensity seems to be maintained during this period till 400 BCE. From this moment, we can see a sharp intensity decrease that seems not to appears with the previous models, and also a rapid intensity increase after the change of the era. Here we can see a minimum also around the change of the era, and since that for the last centuries and for the last millennium, our curve and the previous model seems to fit well. So if we focus on this time window from 400 BCE to 400 CE, we can see this V shape with this sharp intensity decrease. So we want to analyze if this feature could be for a non-dipolar origin. So in order to analyze this feature, we update the shock model. Not to present a new model, it's more to use it like a tool to understand this behavior of the geomagnetic field. So here in the in black line, it's the updated model, and we can see that, for example, for the declination, since that this new model fits better with the value that seems to be a large dispersion with the previous model. And also in terms of intensity, the new model seems to also to predict better this sharp intensity decrease. So with this new model, we studied the non-dipolar field. So what we tried to analyze was like the direction, but also the intensity. So in this first figure, we made a polar plot where we present with the red dots the virtual geomagnetic pole obtained with our directional data, and in black dots we present the geomagnetic pole obtained with the model. So in this figure we can see that the biggest or the largest difference between the virtual geomagnetic pole and the prediction for the model, it's around 150 BCE, which also corresponds to this sharp intensity decrease. But also we can see this similar behavior if we analyze the virtual axial dipole moment in blue dots, obtaining with the previous and with our intensity data. And we also plot the DM with black dots. So here we can see also the largest difference were around the first century BCE, which also correspond to this sharp intensity decrease that we observe for the paleointensity data. To continue with this study, we decided to analyze the radial component of the magnetic field at the Coleman-Thur boundary that appears in this first figure, but also the non-dipolar intensity on the surface. Both analyses are at the 25 BCE, where we found the minimum of the intensity with our previous data. Here we present with this black star is the coordinate for Termes. So here we can see that we have a reverse flux path for Uzbekistan coordinates, but also we can see a non-dipolar features, a non-dipolar intensity at the surface. So also to understand this behavior, but the evolution with the time, we can see that we obtain positive values for the radial component around 200 BCE with maximum values around the change of the era, and then minimum value or negative values also around 100 CE. This behavior is also similar to the intensity, the V-shape that we observe in our curve. Also similar trend, it's observed for the non-dipolar intensity. So also to analyze this behavior, but the temporal evolution of this reverse flux path, we have this movie that they start at 400 BCE. So here we can see the Termes coordinate. So we can see that the reverse, wait, sorry, the reverse flute spot appears around also around 300 BCE, and we have the maximum values around 50 BCE. So then this flute spot seems to move to north hemisphere, so migrates to the area that it's usually or it's more common for these values. And here it's like these flute spots at the end disappear at 400 CE. So in conclusion, in this work, we present 96 new palindensity data from Central Asia. And we present the first 9 full vector for this area. And the first paleosecular variation curve for the intensity for the last 4,000 years in Central Asia. Thanks to this curve, we observe this V-shaped pattern in the intensity around the change of the era. And analyzing the radial component of the magnetic field, we observe a reverse flux path at the Termez coordinates. So thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you very much, Raquel. Big round of applause around. And so if anybody has questions, please feel free to raise your hand or you can use the chat. Very nice presentation, by the way. Yes, please go ahead.
Hey, I may have lost concentration to missed something at the beginning. The dating. All of your things were lined to the nearest 100 years. Is that really the accuracy, the maximal accuracy of your dating?
Yes, I have here the, sorry, the,
page
how
18.
We date the...
Yeah.
Ah, sorry.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
Just a moment. Yes. So here we have the dating of the samples. And sorry, did you ask for the last, for the oldest one or?
Well, I was just looking at your, I think, page 18, slide 18,
mm-hmm.
when I first noticed it. It was probably there earlier as well. Where are we? Yeah, that, okay, that one, sorry, then, 17, sorry. Back one.
Okay.
So I just noticed everything lining up in lines.
In
vertically, they're all lined to the nearest 100 years or something, aren't they?
In the these ones, you mean?
Yeah.
You mean the large difference between the values or the age?
The ages. So
yes, I have to say that the we are working on these collections because those ones are already published, but we are working on those collections because. For this period, it's not so easy to know the date because now the team of the archaeologists are working on this area. But yes, in some cases, we have radiocarbon dating, so seems to be okay. And now we are working a little bit more on this to precise the ages.
Okay.
But yes, but seems to be okay.
No, it's just because you're looking at the variations you're seeing. For example, in that green curve around minus 2000, then the variations in your data set could be variations of the data, but they could also be variations in the age. And
yes,
it would be nice if we had the fact that you've given these ages to the nearest 100 years, have you no more precision than that, even if you're not sure of its accuracy?
Yes, also, we didn't present it here, but we are also working in try to give a new program to try to give a new dating for these samples that have a huge error. So, well, we are working also on that to try to have less error in the on the edge. But yes, you're right. If we have a large error, it's difficult sometimes.
The thing I was noticing was that you had fixed them all at the same age. Is that because they're all
Yes.
at one site or?
Yes.
Okay.
They are one from one side.
Okay. Thanks.
So is there any other question? I didn't see if somebody was trying to talk.
I guess I have a question I could ask.
Sure.
Thanks for your talk. That's really interesting work and very important to do to get the full vector representation from Central Asia is really great. What I'm wondering through a model, you've invoked the development of a reverse flux patch. Is this the only explanation for this, do you think? Is that based on the limited directional data that you have plus the paleo intensities, or are there other possible ways of explaining this drop over the turn of the era?
Well, we tried not only with this model, we tried also with different models to see if we saw this flux patch, not only to just in case that is it's something for our new data, but not we see this reverse flux patch with other models. So I think that if we compare all of these models and for all of them we see this feature seems to be, for me, seems to be okay. But also, yes, when you see intensity decrease, I think that it's important also to check the direction, because maybe it's also a tilt of the bolt, not only something about this reverse flux path. But we check and seems that it's more about that than a tilt of the bolt.
Yeah, just okay, thanks. Just as a follow-up, do you have a sense of which kind of non-dipole components might be contributing in that case, or is that sort of just a generalization?
No, for the moment, it's just a general view.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you. So, Kathy?
Yeah, if I can follow up on Phil's question. There's a lot of models available these days, and I'm hearing from you that it's a common feature of all of these models. Is that right?
Yes, we tried with the ArcalMac and with the Shao-Shock family.
I see. Okay. So I guess my next question might be, did you do the test of looking at the misfit to the observations if you assume that the field changes were purely dipolar? So if you imagine that you just had changes in the dipole moment and the dipole tilt, would that not fit your directional observations on which you're basing this? It's sort of so we know that these models are quite variable in what we see at the core mantle boundary, and so I was just wondering whether you had done the test of how much misfit to your observations you would get if you supposed that everything was dipolar.
Yes, I think that the for this the plot that I show, where we found where we plot the virtual geomagnetic pole with the geomagnetic pole of the of obtained with the model. I think that it could be, I mean, if we have largest difference between the thing that should be just the polar part and the part that we have all together with the data, I think it's a good point to see the difference.
I see. Thank you. Thank you for your talk, by the way. I think it's really nice to see these additional data coming in from Central Asia. They're a really key part of trying to constrain what's going on.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy. There is a question in the chat from Gunther. Gunther enjoyed your talk. Did you check the? Oh, hi. Do you want to say your question?
I enjoyed your talk, and yeah, I didn't. I wasn't there from the very beginning, so I wonder if you maybe you have showed it. Did you also show the magnetic anomaly? So because of the local geology, like a geology map that would show magnetic anomalies over the area where you collected your samples.
No, we didn't check magnetic anomalies in this area.
Okay, thank you. I think it may be relevant because sometimes when you have a stronger inducing bodies, then you may have a stronger intensity and vice versa.
Mm-hmm. No, we didn't check, but it's a good point to check for the next studies. Thank you.
And I enjoyed your talk. I really enjoyed that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gunther. Any other questions?
I have a short question, if I can. Okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Raquel, congratulations. I really liked your talk, and congratulations for producing so many data. I mean, it's really incredible. Explanation about the difference in density values you notice when from the same side when you study ceramics and kilns, but also you notice you have quite large differences between different ceramics from the same site. Do you have an explanation on that? Could be difference on levels or age or I don't know what. Thank you.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's. I think it could be because of the age, and also, I mean, it's a high quality. We were really restricted about the criteria that we use to obtain the pallid intensity, and I mean, it's not that I plot or I show just the most beautiful ones. No, it's because all of them was really like that. So I think that it could be something for the age, or maybe if we are not really sure about, because okay, we have like the coordinates for one archaeological site, but if we have a ceramic, we don't really know if they came from this site or the heat it was at that point. So I think that the well, in the perfect scenario, to analyze the geomagnetic field, the best thing to study the changes is to have kilns, because we know that it's that the heated process was the same. The age could be, well, it could be better or not constrained, but it's I mean, it's better understand it, no? So I don't really sure about why is this dispersion of the for the same ages, for the same ceramic ages, but I think that could be for that, because at the end we have an error in the age of maybe 200 years. So, and to this together with the error of the intensity and all together, I think that could be the reason, because we have this dispersion of the intensity. But I think it's good, it's a good idea to have all of this data, because at the end we can fix it, we can try to fit it with the curves or with models, so at the end we will have the trend of the geomagnetic field. So I think it's important to have a big amount of data to try to understand what's happening in the earth magnetic field.
So the ceramics were not produced in the same kilns. Were not directly connected with the kilns. Were different productions.
No, yes, could be different because are from the same archaeological site, but not the same kiln.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Brigia. Don't know if there are other questions. Otherwise, we give Raquel another big round of applause. Thank you very much. And I want to share the screen with you. So thanks again for coming. Our next speaker will be in 2 weeks' time. And this webinar, together with the previous ones, you can find it on YouTube. And yeah, thanks again for coming, and see you next time.